By now, you've probably seen some headlines talking about a major hack that just happened involving some of the world's biggest companies like Shell, British Airways, BBC, including some government agencies in the US. And this involved a zero-day exploit for a software called MoveIt file transfer service that is basically used to securely transfer files that are supposedly mission critical, they say. So in this video, I'll go over really two topics. One, talking a little bit more about how this exploit worked, and also another general topic talking about how you might be wondering, why do all these companies keep getting hacked, and are you, as a regular user, residential user of the internet, also at risk of these same hacks? So first, talking about this hack, it was originally disclosed on May 31st by the parent company that owns this software, but apparently the ransomware group that used this knew about this for like over a year and was possibly even looking for it since 2021. And like I mentioned, this was a zero-day exploit, which means that the day everyone found out about it, including the company, was the day the hackers revealed that they were using it actively. So there was no time to prepare for it. The second they found out about it was because it was being used to attack people. And while the company did release a patch on May 31st, apparently there were more issues and vulnerabilities because they also released patches on June 9th and June 15th. And there's actually a couple CVEs, which are like exploit identifiers. And basically how this exploit worked is it was an SQL injection. SQL is a database, and a SQL injection is basically tricking the program into making a request to the database that it's not supposed to. In this case, the MoveIt software was exposed to the internet, kind of had to be for its purpose, and the hackers figured out that if they make a special request to the web portal, web interface, or whatever on the back end, that they could get a certain file running there to effectively create a new user with admin privileges and add a web shell, it's called, to accept controls from the hacker and basically do arbitrary code execution, whatever they want to do with it, which included not just stealing all the data and literally looking at everything they had in their MoveIt transfer database and sending it to the hackers, but also encrypting all of it locally and demanding the ransom for it. And I was reading some articles trying to get more details about exactly how this worked, and I wasn't really able to piece too much together, but basically, from what I understand, there was one exploit that involved being able to manipulate the database, which was the first SQL injection, and then there was another exploit that was able to do the remote code execution. Because from at least one article by the company Huntress, they wrote up a really good article, I can link it in the description, they said that the web shell file that they dropped, which they called human2.aspx, they say that dropping this control web portal shell thing was not necessary actually to execute the remote code. They could immediately go to deploying the ransomware if they wanted. So again, I'm not 100% sure. And in this article, they also showed a couple examples of some of the requests that were made to do this. And you can see there's a couple files that were accessed. One was a guest access ASPX file, another was a DLL, and apparently you could send a request such that the DLL did some stuff that was not supposed to. And once they had this web shell up and running so they could control the hacked server, it could do a few different things depending on what the hacker wanted. For example, it could retrieve the Azure system settings and enumerate the underlying SQL database, basically tell them what's in the database. It also allowed the hacker, once they knew what was in the database, they could send a request to have the shell send any file that they wanted by that name out. And it looks like it was also able to delete a account called Health Check Service and replace it with its own with admin privileges and its own password, which could then be further used to control the computer. And what makes this hack especially bad is not just that it was a bunch of big companies, but also the exploit literally had to do with a file transfer service that was meant to transfer secure files that like had to be very secure. So they got all of that. And again, also involved some government agencies, at least a couple like the Department of Energy. And other reports are saying the U.S. Department of Agriculture and also the U.S. Office of Personnel Management. So a lot of stuff going on here. So having heard all this and about a bunch of hacks in the past, you might be wondering, why is it always only companies that seem to get hacked? And why is it never mass hacks of people that get hacked? And really, there's a couple main reasons for this. The first is that a lot of enterprise software gets targeted simply because big companies have the money to pay the ransoms. They're going for the money. But another reason is because a lot of times the way these hacks work, including this past one, with a zero-day exploit, it requires you to be able to interface with that system in the first place to send the exploit command or whatever it is. And that requires that you have some kind of public internet-facing server or web interface running on your computer, and most people simply don't have that because it requires port forwarding, which a lot of people don't even know what that is, let alone bothering to do it. I know what port forwarding is, and I don't have a reason to do it. But these companies that are running these servers, you know, they might host a website, so they of course have to have something public facing so people can access the website. Also, external services that employees might need to use if they're not literally within the office. So they have to have some public facing stuff. And in this case, the MOVEit service was public facing, and that's why they were able to be sent those commands. Whereas usually with any consumer grade router, even the default of the firewall is to simply block any kind of packet that's incoming that was not solicited. So if your computer sends out a packet and a request, then it'll get a response and basically have some information to tell the router that it is a response to something, and then it'll let it through. But if you just get a out of the blue request, the firewall is just gonna completely discard it. So it's not gonna get into your network in any way, unless, say, you are hosting a game server or something on your network, then you can open a port which forwards some of the data to that specific server on that port so that people can connect to it. But that also means that, of course, that if there's an exploit on that game server, then someone can connect and use it. But again, going back to the main topic, most people by far do not do that. So most of the time, it's just not worth it to target software that most people, even if they have it installed, it's not going to be public facing in any way. And even if you do hack a lot of those people, are they going to have a lot of money to pay? It might just be easier to send out mass phishing emails with a virus attached or something like that. So that's usually how individual people get attacked, is downloading something, not a zero-day exploit on their network coming in as a request. The other type of zero-day exploit is like if it's a web browser exploit, then if you go on a website that interfaces with the browser, that could also be an option. And that's another reason why you always want to keep your browser and any software you have installed on your computer up to date, including the operating system itself, because it doesn't have to just be public facing and port forwarded to get hacked. If you go out and touch something that is designed to infect and exploit vulnerable software, then you might get got. And also another advantage hackers can have is they can basically scan the internet for how many servers are out there that are running a particular software that they know they can hack. So they can basically figure out if it's worth it or not from the get-go. And in that article by Huntress, they mentioned that they did a scan and found at least 2,500 servers that were publicly running this MOVEit software. And you better hope that they're all patched. Though again, the problem with the zero day is by the time they found out about the hack, it was already being used. So they kind of hit a bunch of companies at the same time. There wasn't any time to react until after the fact. And you could maybe look to see if you were hacked and limit the damage afterwards and make sure that they're not still in there, but that's really all you could do. They probably already got all the stuff. But again, going back to the main point, as a regular residential internet user, you don't really have to worry about these kinds of specific attacks. Mainly, you're gonna be looking out for phishing attacks, links to malicious software downloads, that sort of thing is more targeted towards individual users. So those are just some thoughts. If you have more to add, or maybe I messed something up, of course, let me know down in the comments. I do try to read as many as I can. And also, if you enjoyed the video, be sure to give it a big giant thumbs up for the YouTube algorithm. And if you want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is where I was talking about some security tips for Chromium browsers like Google Chrome, Edge, and also Firefox as well. So definitely recommend watching that. I'll put that link right there. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.